Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, we're going to look at how exercise can add a lot of years onto your life. This supports an additional study that was done last week, and a lot more on health and healing. And today we're also going to do commentaries, a commentary from Chris Hedges' Truth Dig, The Coming Collapse. Also, I'm going to show the absurdity of what happens when the mainstream media does not call out the people who are really acting foolish like John McCain. We will. He went to the Middle East. He went to Syria. He had his photo op taken. Did anyone in the media bother to pay attention to who was in the photograph with him? We have. You'll be shocked to know who's in the photograph with John McCain. Not a single word from the mainstream media. Maybe after this show, they might challenge him. Also, let's take a closer look at the religion of libertarianism today, deconstructed. And today, Gina Haspels is being sworn in as the new head of the CIA. Why should we all be concerned? After all she did was personally supervise people being tortured to death and destroying evidence about the CIA's torture program. What could possibly go wrong? Also from Prince EA, man versus earth. Man's winning, unfortunately. And we have a clip. Very interesting one. I'm only going to play a part of it from a ex-drone operator about what it was like to sit in a comfortable air-conditioned booth out in the Las Vegas desert and kill people around the world. Also, something you have not heard, will not hear from anyone in our Congress, someone speaking up about the massacre in Gaza, but a member of the British Parliament did. We'll play that. And are you aware what happened last week? It slipped by rather easily for most people to miss. The left defended MS-13. Do you know who MS-13 is? They're the most ruthless gang in the world. Part of their initiation rites are killing people. And I put up a picture, which I normally would not, on my Facebook to show you the work of MS-13. It's a gruesome picture. Unless you have are able to handle that, you don't want to look at it. But for those who naively believe that, MS-13, they're not animals, well, why don't you tell the person whose tongue was cut out and about 70 knives all stuck in the guy's eyes, body, neck, throat, heart, and they're there. You see them. That is considered normal for MS-13. And yet, for political reasons, for ideological reasons, you're defending them? Shame on all of you who defended MS-13. Let's see what you would think if you were one of the victims of their assaults. As you see, we have a lot to share. Let's begin. Last week, I mentioned that exercising, what I believe should be ideal, would be, let's just say that you exercised, let's make it simple. For the average person working up to where they're doing about 45 minutes a day. Okay, you do 45 minutes a day times 6 days, you're at 270 minutes. So let's say that we say that 200 minutes minimum, 400 minutes maximum per week. Then you're adding on about anywhere from 7 to 9 years to your life. This is a brand new study published in the Journal of Physiology from the University of Texas. And they're stating that participating in exercise 4 to 5 days per week is necessary to keep your heart young. They're specifically looking at your heart. And in effect, they're saying that you can slow down aging of the heart and your blood vessels. And that's been a matter of vigorous debate, by the way. But here's the reality. As you age, especially if you're over the age of 27, your arteries, which transport blood in and out of the heart, are prone to stiffening, which increases the risk of heart disease. And while any form of exercise reduces the overall risk of death from heart problems, this new research shows the sizes of your arteries are affected differently by varying amounts of exercise. For example, 2 to 3 days a week of 30-minute exercises may be sufficient to minimize stiffening of the middle-sized arteries, while if you exercise 4 to 5 days a week, it keeps the larger central arteries youthful. And boy, is that important. And so this was an important study. So for all of you, if you want to have younger heart, healthier blood vessels, healthier, more pliable arteries, which supply oxygenated blood to your head and your neck and keep your body from having strokes, then do your exercise. There's some nanoparticles. Nano are very small particles. They're derived from tea leaves. And guess what? New research from Swansea University in Wales show they destroy lung cancer cells. Now, I know there are people listening to this program right now who have lung cancer. So you should get the study because the nanoparticles derived from tea leaves inhibit the growth of lung cancer cells, destroying up to 80% of them. That is what this has shown. The team made the discovery while they were testing out a new method of producing a type of nanoparticle called quantum dots. Now, these are tiny particles which measure less than 10 nanometers. By the way, how small is that? A human hair is 40,000 nanometers, and this is 10. 40,010. That's so small you couldn't see it. And although nanoparticles are already used in healthcare, quantum dots have only recently attracted research attention, and already they're showing promise for use in different applications, from computers and solar cells to tumor imaging and treating cancer. And quantum dots, that's DOTS, can be made chemically, but this is complicated and expensive and has toxic side effects. I don't recommend it. So this Swansea-led research team explored non-toxic plant-based alternative methods of producing the dots using tea leaf extract. And the tea leaves contain a wide variety of compounds. We talk about polyphenols, amino acids, vitamins, antioxidants, and in green tea in particular. And the researchers mixed the tea leaf extract with a cadmium sulfate and sodium sulfide and allowed the solution to incubate, a process which causes quantum dots to form. They then applied the dots to lung cancer cells, and they found that the tea leaves are a simpler, cheaper, and less toxic method of producing quantum dots compared to chemicals, and quantum dots produced from tea leaves inhibit the growth of lung cancer cells. And they penetrated into the nanopores of the cancer cell and destroyed them up to 80%. This is really important. And this was published in Applied Nanomaterials. There were two universities involved here, two Indian universities plus the Swansea University. So for all of you of lung cancer, important. Sometimes you have to allow, up to a certain point, your body to get warm in order to deal with tumors. And there's new research out of the University of Warwick, which is in the United Kingdom, that the hotter bodies fight infections and tumors better. So quite simply, the hotter our body temperature, the more our body speed up a key defense system that fights against tumors and wounds and infections. So new research from a multidisciplinary team of mathematicians and biologists from the universities of Warwick and Manchester has found. and the researchers have demonstrated that small rises in temperature, such as during a fever, speed up the speed of the cellular clock that controls the response to infections. And this new understanding could lead to more effective and fast-working treatments that are involved in the process. So this was heating up the body for people with HIV infection, form of hyperthermia, and also for cancer was popular in the 1980s, fell out of popularity, but they are now bringing it back. From the Aga Khan University in Pakistan, it's shown that vitamin D3 boost helps treat child malnutrition. And this was from high doses of vitamin D3 can help treat severe child malnutrition, which is epidemic throughout the world, especially in South America, in Central Asia, and in Africa. So along with vitamin A, which is important, vitamin D3 is also important. And we should be, and both of these are inexpensive. So we should be producing billions of them. And then in each family, in each village, give a nutrition kit that would contain D3, vitamin C, probiotics, and that will help the child. That's easy to do. Now, I was approached a year and a half ago by a group of health professionals out of Australia, and they had followed my work, and they said, could you put together a nutritional protocol to help refugees? And I said, sure, be happy to. And I told them my brother Stephen had been responsible for doing this, getting the lead out of the blood of children with chelation therapy in India, and also got the lead out of gasoline in India, and then took a group of physicians, I think the last group was 40, just 2 months ago, down to the Dominican Republic, and then he gives all the pregnant women a multiple vitamin to help them prevent eclampsia and premature birth weights, et cetera, so they have healthier children. And he's done over 80 million bottles of that. So I said, so we're used to helping people who may not have full spectrum nutrition. So I put together a formula that will give a family their proteins, all from plant-based, their amino acid profiles, vitamins, minerals, electrolytes, probiotics, polyphenols, enough for 90-day supply. And so that way, even if they're poor and even if they're in a very untenable position in a refugee camp, they would have good nutrition. And they accepted that formulation. So now I'll be going over again. I'm going to go, I believe this summer, to Greece, to an island that has refugee camps, and helping determine the nutritional deficiencies or nutritional needs of the people in the camps, and at least getting them something for free to them, of course, that they can use on a daily basis with that same identical formula, just for anyone in this audience who may be in helping people in Africa or other places where you have malnourished children. This could save millions of lives. Remember, we have 25,000 children dying of waterborne disease and malnutrition, dehydration, every 24 hours in the world. You're talking about a major scourge. Now, when you consider how wealthy we are as a nation and how easy this is to achieve, then there's no legitimate reason we shouldn't be saving more lives. Anyhow, this particular article from Aga Khan University in Pakistan was published in sciencedev.net. Also, for those of you who have a larger waistline, you know, you have the belly, you have a higher risk of vitamin D deficiency. This is from the VA University Medical Center and Leiden University Medical Center in the Netherlands. So if you're overweight, then simply make sure you're getting more vitamin D. I would suggest to be on the safe side, 3,000 units a day. And to help prevent blood clots, which means helping to prevent strokes and heart attack, a flavonoid found in foods and supplements can help prevent that. This is from Beth Israel Medical Center. It's called rutin, R-U-T-I-N, inexpensive, easy to find. You can get it in any health food store. And it's also common in fruits and vegetables. And it inhibits the formation of blood clots, and that can help prevent thrombosis. So this was published in the Journal of Clinical Nutrition. And I would use rutin with quercetin and vitamin C. They work synergistically together. Just something simple. And they began conducting these screening processes to see what would help prevent blood clots. And they checked 5,000 compounds that were screened, and quercetin 3 rutinoside, or rutin, emerged as the most potent agent. Quite simply, rutin was essentially the champion found. It's a bioflavonoid. You find it in onions, apples, citrus fruit. But I think you'd be better off just getting it as a supplement because you could get a higher potency. University of Aarhus in Copenhagen in Denmark, people who grew up without green spaces are 50% more likely to develop mental conditions compared to those who grew up surrounded by greenery. One more piece of evidence, as if we needed it, that being in green spaces around grassy fields and forests, fields of corn, all type of vegetation count. Being on a farm, it makes a difference in our mental health. And from Tokyo University of Science, taurine, T-A-U-R-I-N-E, taurine, that's amino acid. It activates the autophagy in adipocytes. Quite simply, in lay language, it means that if you have taurine, you're less likely to maintain your obesity. And for those of you who are going to be drinking cow or cow's milk and cow milk products, according to University of Minnesota, as well as Johns Hopkins University, plus University of Newcastle in the United Kingdom, and Southern Cross University in Australia, foraging-based diets, meaning a cow that goes out into a field and eats dandelion greens and grasses and wildflowers and herbs that are naturally growing, is going to have much healthier omega-6 and omega-3 fatty acids, which are essential to our health, and rather than those that are eating grains and kept in factory farming. So always look, if you are going to buy any dairy products, make sure it's from field organic grass that they were feeding on. It's healthier. And finally, I believe the most under-recognized mineral is magnesium. Magnesium is the fourth most abundant mineral in your body, and it's the reason why vegetables are green. But most people don't realize how important it is. And the Human Genome Project reveals that 3,751 human proteins have binding sites for magnesium. And so far, we know this one essential mineral activates over 350 biological processes in the body to keep things flowing. And plants from green because they contain the light-harvesting molecule chlorophyll, which bears a striking resemblance to the human hemoglobin. In fact, with the difference that the latter contains an oxygen-binding iron atom and not magnesium. So magnesium deficiency is often misdiagnosed because it does not show up in blood tests. Only 1% of the body's magnesium is stored in the blood. And it's been estimated that about 80% of the population is deficient in magnesium. When I counsel people, I'm always finding that they have magnesium deficiencies. First, it can prevent migraines. Secondly, It can lower heart disease death rates. Just read the journal Atherosclerosis that found that people with low magnesium levels are more than twice as likely to die of heart disease. And they were more than 700% more likely to die from all causes. It also manages diabetes. It relieves symptoms of fibromyalgia. It lowers your risk of colon cancer. And it builds strong bones. And it reduces the signs of metabolic syndrome, which is diabetes. Those are just some of the reasons. Remember, if you want a steady heart rhythm, if you have AFib, magnesium. If you want normal blood pressure, magnesium. Reduce your risk of stroke, the same. Help maintain normal muscle nerve function, prevents gallstone disease, helps support your immune system, improves symptoms of autism, regulates blood sugar, reduces diabetes risk, helps your memory, improves hearing, reduces symptoms of PMS, improves asthma. Yeah, magnesium. So let's just see that we have magnesium. Seaweed, dark green vegetables like collard greens, spinach, Swiss chard, broccoli, all your bean family, millet, brown rice, quinoa, almonds, cashews, filberts, sesame seeds, lentils, avocados, spirulina, and chlorella. And that's the latest on health and healing. I'm Gary Null, back in a moment. Please stay with us. Okay. Today, I posted on my Facebook a photograph. In the photograph is John McCain smiling, and around him are four individuals. No one seemed to pay attention. After all, he was in the Middle East to support the effort the Americans supported moderate people against Assad. Look carefully. The person right over his shoulder is Abu Musa, the ISIS press officer, the head of their propaganda. The person over his right behind him is Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi. He is, are you ready for this? He is the head of ISIS. He's right behind John McCain, the head of ISIS. Then you see John McCain. Then you see off to McCain's left, in the doorway right behind McCain, you see Mohammed Noor, N-O-O-R. He's a known Syrian terrorist. And the other person smiling in front of the camera is Musa Mustafa, and he is with the Syrian Emergency Task Force. Again, terrorist groups. So good work there, John. You never saw a war you didn't like or support. You got four of the terrorists that we're supposed to be fighting, and you're in a photo op with them? And by the way, that's not the first photo op. He's with the wrong people. Take a look, everyone. Share that with the media. Let's see if they still think that that's okay not to pay attention to the basics. Now we're also, I got a email this morning from Jesse at Progressive Radio Network. And he said, Gary, since starting the new series on Wikipedia, the Gary Null Show has been listened to a total of 106,000 times, mainly in downloads. So at least a minimum of 106,000 people since I started and did five programs in the last 8 days on Wikipedia. So that's just on that. That's just, and we have 19 different streams going out. So here's the takeaway message. If you go up to prn.fm and you go to the homepage, you'll see a series of investigations, two, part one and part two, on Wikipedia and the new internet McCarthyism. You then see one on homeopathy, and the latest was on plant-based healing and how they attack it, and we show the legitimacy of the science. tens of thousands of studies supporting ginseng and other natural herbs. But now I'm getting feedback that we're not alone. In fact, I'm getting emails today that all kinds of people are being attacked. Roger Mark, thank you for sending this. It says, Dear Gary, I truly hope that you are successful in your efforts to have the truth be told and realize a vindication against Wikipedia. I can remember not long ago when I was searching for a link to PRN that I came across your Wikipedia page. I recall feeling outraged and angered by the untruths I was reading. You are correct. It is nothing more than slander and character assassination. Granted, your Wiki page had no negative effect on me. I've been following you since the 1970s. However, it saddens me to think that people who are new to your messages will be turned away. And also, they're also attacking many others, including William Benny. By the way, William Benny, yes, he is being attacked because he was one of the first and most significant whistleblowers at the National Security Agency, telling us the truth, how they were spying on us. But it turns out that there are others as well, and we're inviting them on the program. So it's not just in health and nutrition. For example, Wikipedia is going after Craig Murphy, the ambassador. Who's Craig Murray? He was the one that received the documents and a thumb drive from an insider working at the Democratic National Office headquarters, and he was supporter of Bernie Sanders, and he saw that Bernie Sanders was unethically and illegally being deceived, and his followers giving the nomination to Hillary. So he took all those documents, what was going on, and he met in a park right beside American University and handed them off to Greg Murray. Murray then got him in the hands of Julian Assange. Well, now he's being attacked, but he's not the only one. Turns out, quote, time to ditch Wikipedia. A look at a Wikipedia editor's long-running campaign to discredit anti-war campaigners and journalists. And this I posted today. It's called Wikipedia Five Filters. A Wikipedia editor called Philip Cross, Andrew Philip Cross, later Julian, on Twitter, has a long record of editing the entries of many anti-war figures on the site to include mostly critical commentary while removing positive information contributed by others. At time of writing, he is number 308 in the list of Wikipedians by number of edits. Well, Wikipedia's own rules show that if you have bias against someone, you can't edit their work. So we thought it was just in the area of health and healing and alternative medicine. Now we're saying they have a whole deep state campaign going against anti-war people, and I'm getting more information coming in, and we will share this with you. And by the way, on an upcoming program, we will have seven individuals all attacked on Wikipedia from seven different fields, and they'll all have the same evidence that we had: inability to correct misinformation, editors who have shown bias. So now we should start the movement to share every article we have from Wikipedia that I have challenged them on with as many people as you can. If we have 107,000 people that have downloaded those, share them. Let's make it 5 million people who have this information. I won't tell you what the end game is, but I will tell you that as big and powerful as Wikipedia is, its day of reckoning is in the future. It's not going away. Now, we're going over because I want you to first hear Prince, EA, talk about Man versus Earth. It's a short piece. And because I think we have to keep reminding ourselves that every time you want something new, you want a new cell phone, you want to live in a different neighborhood, you want some kind of furniture, you want the new car, nature had to be affected by having all that we possess and crave and feel that we need this stuff. Let us not forget that. Here is Prince EA on Man versus Earth.
Fun fact, planet Earth is 4.5 billion years old. Mankind, about 140,000 years old. Let me put that in perspective. If you condense the Earth's lifespan into 24 hours, that's one full day, then we have been here on this planet for, drum roll please, 3 seconds. 3 seconds. And look what we've done. We have modestly named ourselves Homo sapiens, meaning wise man. But is man really so wise? Smart, yes, and it's good to be smart, but not too smart for your own good. Yes, we have split the atom. Yes, we build clever machines that navigate the universe in search of new homes, but at the same time, those atoms we split created nuclear warfare. In our quest to explore the galaxy, rejects and neglects the home that we have here now, so no, that cannot be wisdom. Wisdom is different. While intelligence speaks, wisdom listens, and we willingly covered our ears to Mother Nature's screams and closed our eyes to all of her help-wanted signs. Wisdom knows that every action has an equal and opposite reaction, so if we were wise, we would not be shocked when we see storms that are stronger than ever before, or more drought, hurricanes, and wildfire than ever before, because there's more pollution than ever before, more carbon, more trees cut down than ever before. At a record pace, we have increased the extinction of animals by 1,000 times the normal rate. What a feat. In the next 10 to 100 years, every beloved animal character in every children's book is predicted to go extinct. Lions gone, rhinos gone, tiger, gorilla, elephant, polar bear gone in 3 seconds. Species that have been here longer than us will be gone because of us in this 3 seconds. In an existence shorter than a Vine video, we turn the circle of life into our own personal conveyor belt. Somebody, anybody, help. We were given so much. The only planet in this solar system with life. I mean, we are one in a million. No, actually, scientifically, we are one in a billion, trillion, trillion. That's a one followed by 33 zeros. And I don't want to get too spiritual, but how are we not a miracle? We are perfectly positioned to the sun so we don't burn, but not too distant so we don't turn to ice. Goldilocks said it best. We are just right. This paradise where we are given medicine from trees, not coincidentally, but because like the song says, we are family. Literally, everything, every species is connected genetically, from the sunflower to the sunfish. And this is what we must recognize before it's too late, because the real crisis is not global warming, environmental destruction, or animal agriculture. It is us. These problems are symptoms of us, byproducts of us, our inner reflection. Loss of connection has created this misdirection. We have forgotten that everything contributes to the perfection of Mother Nature. Corporations keep us unaware and disconnected, but they have underestimated our strength. Contrary to popular belief, millions are waking up out of their sleep, seeing our home being taken right up under our feet. We cannot allow our history to be written by the wicked, greedy, and loony. It is our duty to protect Mother Nature from those who refuse to see her beauty. Call me crazy, but I believe we should have the right to eat food that's safe, with ingredients we can pronounce, drink water that is clean, marvel at trees, breathe air free of toxins. These are natural rights, not things that can be bargained for in Congress. See, they want you to feel powerless, but it has been said that something as small as the flutter of a butterfly's wing can cause a typhoon halfway around the world. But when enough people come together, we too will make waves and watch the world into a new era filled with love and connection, freedom for all without oppression. But it is up to you, yes, you watching this behind this screen, to make the effort, because time is of the essence, and only together can we make it to the 4th second.
Also posted today on my Facebook page, I try to post about 40 to 60 articles or motivating and inspiring little clips each day, is this. You have mercury in your teeth. You've been injected dozens of times with mercury, aluminum, and multiple other excitotoxins, neurotoxins. You're breathing nanoparticle aluminum, barium salts, and lithium. Your food has been poisoned with heavy metals, aspartame, monosodium glutamate, and dozens of other neurotoxins. Your municipal water is poisoned with brain-destroying hydrofluorocytic acid, lead, aluminum, chlorine, and other neurotoxins. You've been indoctrinated in globalist public schools, mesmerized and mind-controlled by globalist-controlled news and entertainment media, and your government continually lies to you, threatens you with violence, and scares you into submission with false flag attacks. So no, I'm neither surprised nor upset when you pose stupid arguments and call me a conspiracy theorist. I understand, and I forgive you. Now let us go over and hear from something we did not have the courage, the decency, the moral value to discuss in our own Congress or the media, and that is the truth being spoken about what is happening to this Palestinian people. This is a member of parliament, one of the inner circle of Jeremy Corbyn's group, called, in its short, the Gaza Massacre.
Emily Thornberry.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I'm very grateful to you for granting this urgent question. Yesterday's horrific massacre at the Gaza border left at least 58 dead and almost 3,000 injured. And our first thoughts today are with those Palestinians mourning their loved ones or waking up with life-changing injuries. And what makes yesterday's events all the worst is that they didn't come as a result of some accidental overreaction to one day's protests, but as the result of a culmination of 6 weeks, an apparently calculated and deliberate policy to kill and maim unarmed protesters who pose no threat to the forces on the Gaza border. Many of them shot in the back, many of them shot hundreds of meters from the border, and many of them children. Yeah. And if we are in any doubt, Mr. Speaker, about the lethal intent of the Israeli snipers working on the border, I'm afraid we only need to look at the wounds suffered by their victims. On hunting websites, Mr. Speaker, in America, they regularly debate the merits of 7.6-millimeter bullets versus the 5.5-millimeter bullets. The latter, they say, is effective when you want to wound multiple internal organs, while the former is preferred by some because, and I quote, it is designed to mushroom and fragment, to do maximum internal damage to the animal. And it was this ammunition, it is alleged, that was used in Gaza yesterday against men, women, and children. On the very first day of the violence, Mr. Speaker, the UN Secretary General called for an independent investigation into those incidents, and last night the Kuwaiti government asked the UN Security Council to agree a statement doing the same, only to be vetoed by the United States. And while I agree with every word of that Kuwaiti statement, it is easy to see why the US vetoed it, because it was critical of their Jerusalem embassy move. So can I ask the Minister of State today if he will take the initiative, not just in supporting a new Security Council statement, but in helping draft a new statement, making no criticism of any party and no link to any other issue, but simply calling for an urgent, independent investigation into the violence in Gaza, to assess whether international law has been broken, and to hold those responsible to account. A statement that no country could reasonably object to, not even the United States, unless they are prepared to make the case that there is one rule for the government of Israel and another one for everyone else. And I believe that the investigation must just be the start of an effort at the UN and elsewhere to bring urgent and concerted international pressure on the Netanyahu government to lift the illegal blockade on Gaza and comply with all the UN resolutions ordering them to remove their illegal settlements and end their illegal occupation of Palestinian territories. If yesterday's death can act as a catalyst for that action, then at least they will not have been in vain. And in the interim, especially as the protests resume today, will the Minister of State join me in urging the Israeli forces serving on the Gaza border to show some long overdue responsibility to their fellow human beings and stop this vicious slaughter?
Courage to say the truth in Great Britain, no courage whatsoever except for Bernie Sanders in the United States Congress. or the mainstream American media. Now we're going to play a clip about the person who's just about to become, or has already, this morning, the new head of the CIA. And I'm going to share from Jeremy Scahill from The Intercept what he has to say about this. And then we're going to play a clip. Quote, an American doctor, naval reserve officer, has done extensive medical evaluation of a high-profile prisoner who was tortured under the supervision of Gina Haspel, privately urged Senator Mark Werner, the vice chair of the Senate Intelligence Committee, to oppose Haspel's confirmation as CIA director, according to an email obtained by The Intercept. I have evaluated Mr. Abdal Nasari, as well as close to 20 other men who were tortured in U.S. custody, including several who were tortured as part of the CIA's rendition, detention, and interrogation program. I am one of the only health professionals he has ever talked to about his torture, its effects, and ongoing suffering. Dr. Sondra Crosby, a professor of public health at Boston University, wrote to Werner's legislative director on Monday, quote, he is irreversibly damaged by torture that was unusually cruel and designed to break him. In my over 20 years of experience treating torture victims from around the world, including Syria, Iraq, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, Mr. Nasari presents one of the most severely traumatized individuals I've ever seen. Nasari was snatched in Dubai in the United Arab Emirates in 2002 and rendered to Afghanistan by the CIA and eventually taken to the Cat's Eye prison in Thailand that was run by Haspel from October to December 2002. He was suspected of involvement in a 2000 bombing of the USS Cole off the coast of Yemen. He is currently being held at Guantanamo Bay Prison. Despite Crosby's pleas, Werner and five other Democrat senators have announced their support for Haspel. Werner backed Haspel after she sent him a carefully crafted letter designed to give him the impression she had changed her position on torture while simultaneously continuing to defend its efficacy. Quote, while I won't condemn those that made these hard calls, and I have noted the valuable intelligence collected, the program ultimately did damage to our officers and our standing in the world, she wrote. With the benefit of hindsight and my experience as a senior policy agency leader, the enhanced interrogation program is not one the CIA should have undertaken. Haspel stated that she, quote, would refuse to undertake any proposed activity that was contrary to my moral and ethical values. But Haspel has refused to renounce torture, her role in its use, or condemn the practice of waterboarding. In fact, under questioning from Senator Kamala Harris during her confirmation hearing, Haspel explicitly refused to say that the, quote, enhanced interrogation techniques she oversaw personally at a secret CIA prison in Thailand were immoral. That fact renders her pledge to Werner meaningless. Quote, it took her 16 years and the eve of a vote on her confirmation to get even this modest statement, and again, she didn't say that she had any regrets other than offended some people. Quote, I urge Senator Werner to oppose Haspel. Here's what was done. Suffocated with water, waterboarding, subjected to mock execution with a drill and gun while standing naked and hooded, anally raped through rectal feeding, threatened that his mother would be sexually assaulted, lifted off the ground by arms while they were bound behind his back, after which a medical officer opined that shoulders might be dislocated. That's just the beginning of the torture. And by the way, if you think that this is the only time that it was in question, then I suggest that you take a look at what they did with Operation Phoenix in Vietnam. If you're not familiar with that, I'll be dealing with that on tomorrow's program. Now let's hear a few things about Gina Haspel when she was giving evidence about the CIA's torture program, and she is now the new CIA director.
Mitchell recommended to you that the tapes be destroyed?
No,
All of us were concerned about the tapes.
You an advocate for destroying the tapes?
I thought those videotapes should be destroyed.
These are videotapes that subsequently destroyed.
At the time Jose destroyed the tapes.
President Trump's pick for CIA director, veteran spy Gina Haspel, insists she did not realize that the tapes of post-9/11 interrogations would be destroyed.
There's been much debate and much news coverage about Jose Rodriguez, the former director of the National Clandestine Service, and his decision to direct the destruction of the detainee interrogation videotapes. Can you describe for members your role in those events?
I was chief of staff to the deputy director for operations, that is head of the clandestine service. The tape issue had lingered at CIA for a period of about 3 years.
The tapes documented interrogation sessions using brutal techniques, including waterboarding, with Al-Qaeda detainees.
I didn't like the fact that the tapes were out there. I had a visceral reaction to the tapes. I thought they were ugly.
Had you seen them?
Of course I saw them. Mm-hmm.
I felt it was important to have the tapes destroyed because I needed to protect the people who were there in the black sites. And they were not just my people, but they were also people from other directorates that were involved with our team conducting the enhanced interrogation program. Mm-hmm. I mean, we were very concerned about it and had been trying to get them destroyed for years.
In May of 2005, Mr. Rizzo reports, I told Jose and his chief of staff, that was you, is that correct? I can't recall if I talked to them separately or together. They were crestfallen because they were now on notice that the DNI, two successive White House counsels, and the vice president's top lawyer had weighed in strongly against destroying the tapes. Do you recall that conversation?
Senator, I don't recall that specific conversation. However, I was aware that there were some objections, and that is why the Jose was
with
going
all
to go
respect,
back to the
director. Those aren't some objections. Those are very straightforward prohibitions by your superiors to not destroy the tapes. Were they not?
Senator, I don't recall that specific conversation.
By the fall of 2005, the question of what to do with the tapes had been quiet for several months. But then the CIA was hit with a pair of new threats.
Senator Levin introduced legislation to create a commission model on the 9/11 commission to look into the agency's treatment of detainees.
On October 31st, senior CIA counsel John Rizzo sent an email outlining his concern about the proposal.
Were you aware of Senator Levin's actions?
Senator Warner, what I recall were the security issues surrounding the tapes. I don't recall pending legislation.
On November 2nd, the Washington Post published an extensive report on CIA black sites. Rodriguez was among those enlisted to dissuade the paper from publishing some details. On November 3rd, the federal judge overseeing the Mousawi trial ordered the government to search for any video or audio of captured militants. On November 4th, Haspel and Rodriguez contacted the base where the tapes were being held and described how to ask permission to destroy the tapes.
Great deal of public interest just that week in the whole interrogation question. Were you aware of that when you made this decision?
Senator, I do not recall being aware of that.
According to a press story today about the destruction of the interrogation videotapes, Jose Rodriguez told you in advance that he was going to take matters into his own hands. Did that conversation happen?
Senator, no, it did not. Mr. Rodriguez indicated to me that he planned to discuss it with the then director, Goss.
Mr. Rodriguez said that he asked you to ask two questions of the lawyers the day before the drafting of the cable. One was, was it legal to destroy the tape? Second, did he have the authority? Did you mention to those lawyers the intention to issue a cable that would destroy the tapes when you asked those two questions, or were those the only questions you asked?
No, Senator. I explained that Mr. Rodriguez wanted to get resolution on this issue and that he was planning to have a conversation with the director about it, and he needed to have revalidation of those 2 points.
Rodriguez said the answer she got to both questions was yes.
So, again, you got assurance from your lawyers that destroying the tapes was legal?
Correct.
Mr. Rodriguez asked me to prepare a cable because he was going to have another conversation with then-director of the agency to talk about this issue again. I did so.
At the time Jose destroyed the tapes...
What did he do?
He ordered that a cable be written to the field ordering the destruction of the tapes. And at the time, the director of CIA, Porter Goss, was opposed to the destruction of the tapes. At the time, the DNI, John Negroponte, was opposed to the destruction of the tapes. At the time, the White House counsel, Harriet Myers, was opposed to the destruction of the tapes. Jose, who I have great admiration for, a great officer, knew that his superiors, DCI, DNI, were opposed, and knew White House counsel was opposed. Jose went ahead and did it anyway.
He released the order.
So there you have it. Here she is, his chief of staff. He's disobeying the head of the CIA, the top lawyer in the White House. He's disobeying everyone and went ahead and destroyed the tapes. And she was the one who was his right hand, chief of staff. That shows you what kind of person is now going to be running the CIA. If you thought we've had some bad characters in the past running the CIA, the deep state should be very happy today. I'm going to close out today's program with some thoughts. The Trump administration did not rise prima facie, like Venus on a half shell from the sea. Donald Trump is the result of a long process of political, cultural, and social decay. He is a product of our failed democracy. The longer we perpetuate the fiction that we live in a functioning democracy, that Trump and the political mutations around him are somehow an aberrant deviation that can be vanquished in the next election, the more we will hurtle towards tyranny. My personal opinion, we are already in a state of totalitarian rule. We have militarized our police. We are spying on every single person. We are detaining people on any suspicion without due process, without habeas corpus. There is no privacy left. We have made the American people feel as if they are the problem. So the problem is not Trump. It is a political system dominated by corporate power and the mandarins of the two major political parties, in which we don't count. We will wrest back political control by dismantling the corporate state, and this means massive and sustained civil disobedience, like that demonstrated by teachers around the country. Peaceful, yes, necessary. But nonetheless, we must stand up. Otherwise, we will enter a new dark age, according to Chris Hedges. The Democratic Party, which helped build our system of inverted totalitarianism, is once again held up by many on the left as the savior. My goodness, is that misdirected thought? Yet the party steadfastly refuses to address the social inequality that led to the election of Trump and the insurgency by Bernie Sanders. It is deaf, dumb, and blind to the real economic suffering that plagues over half the country. It will not fight to pay workers a living wage. It will not defy the pharmaceutical and insurance industries to provide Medicare for all. It will not curb the voracious appetite of the military that is disemboweling the country and promoting the prosecution of futile and costly foreign wars. It will not restore our lost civil liberties, including the right of privacy, freedom from government surveillance, and due process. Will not get corporate and dark money out of politics. It will not demilitarize our police and reform a prison system that has 25% of the world's prisoners, although we represent less than 5% of the world's population. It plays to the margins, especially in election seasons, refusing to address substantive political and social problems, instead focusing on narrow cultural issues like gay rights and abortion and gun control in our peculiar species of anti-politics. This is a doomed tactic, but one that is understandable. The leadership of the party, the Clintons, Nancy Pelosi, Chuck Schumer, Tom Perez, are creations of corporate America in an open and democratic political process one not dominated by party elites and corporate money, these people would not hold political power. And they know this. They would rather implode the entire system than give up their positions of privilege. And that, I fear, is what will happen. The idea of the Democratic Party is in any way a bulwark against despotism defies the last 30 years of its political activity. It is the guarantor of despotism. Trump has tapped into the hatred that huge segments of the American public have for a political and economic system that has betrayed them. He may be inept, degenerate, dishonest, narcissist, but he is adeptly ridiculing the system that they despise. His cruel and demeaning taunts directed at government agencies, laws, and the established elites resonate with people for whom these agencies, laws, and elites have become hostile forces, and for many who see no shift in the political landscape to alleviate their suffering, Trump's cruelty and invective, or at least cathartic. In conclusion, Donald Trump, like all despots, has no ethical core, no moral values. He has no intellect. He has no common sense and no sense of reason. He is without shame. He chooses his allies and appointees based upon their personal loyalty and fawning divine love for him. He will sell anyone out. He is corrupt, amassing money for himself. He made $40 million from his Washington, D.C. hotel alone last year and his corporate allies. He is dismantling government institutions that once provided some regulation and oversight. He is an enemy of the open society. Now, this makes him dangerous. His turbocharged assault on the last vestiges of democratic institutions and norms means there will soon be nothing, even in name, to protect us from corporate totalitarianism. But the warnings from the architects of our failed democracy against creeping fascism, Madeleine Albright among them, are risible. They show how disconnected the elites have become from the zeitgeist. None of these elites have credibility. They built the edifice of lies, deceit, corporate pillage that made Trump possible. And the more Trump demeans these elites, and the more they cry out like Cassandras, the more he savages his disastrous presidency and enables the kleptocrats pillaging the country as it swiftly disintegrates. The press is one of the principal pillars of Trump's despotism. It chatters endlessly like 17th century courtiers at the court of Versailles about the foibles of the monarchy, while the peasants lack bread. It drones on and on and on about empty topics such as Russian meddling and a payoff to a porn actress that have nothing to do with the daily hell that for many defines life in America. It refuses to critique or investigate the abuses by corporate power, which has destroyed our democracy and economy and orchestrated the largest transfer of wealth upwards in American history. The corporate press is a decayed relic that in exchange for money and access committed cultural suicide. And when Trump attacks it over fake news, he expresses once again the deep hatred of all those the press ignores. The press worships the idols of mammon as slavishly as Trump does. It loves the reality show presidency. The press, especially the cable news shows, keeps the lights on and the cameras rolling so viewers will be glued to a 21st century version of the cabinet of Dr. Calgary. It is good for ratings. It is good for profits. But it accelerates this decline. I'm Gary Null. Thank you all for listening. Have a nice day.